Okay, so we see that we are invited, we are called, we are, you know, this great, awesome friendship with God. You know, there's no other place do we see this, right? No other world we has this. It's like we are invited to this fellowship, this friendship, this partnership with God to carry out the plans and purposes of God, right? So how do we deepen this fellowship? We know that we have this friendship with God. How do we deepen? You know, we continue to talk to Him. We continue to enjoy His presence. Like even as we talk, you know, He is communicating certain things to us. He's speaking to us, strengthening us, and all that. So every time, what does the Holy Spirit do? He glorifies Jesus. Like He lifts up the name of Jesus. Like that's what we saw in John chapter 15, that He glorifies Jesus. And so, you know, when we begin to praise and glorify Jesus, we experience more of His presence. Right? So we do not, when we don't do that, when we dishonor Jesus in whatever way, we actually grieve the Holy Spirit. Right? We grieve the Holy Spirit. We can also quench the Holy Spirit, like we learned, right? Because we stop or resist, stop the work that He's doing midway. It's like throwing water on fire, just put it out, right? That's the word quench, that's the picture that we have. So He begins to do something in us, and then we might completely quench it, because He gives us the will, right? We can either go with it, cooperate, or we can quench, right? So we need to be sensitive. The other thing is that, you know, the work of the Holy Spirit, and the way He communicates through our spirit. He communicates through the Word of God, and He quickens the Word in different ways, like we have seen. It could be something visual. It could be something that we sense, like a weight, right, a prompting, an impression. It could be, you know, just a reference. It could be something pictorial, completely, you know, in amazing ways. He ministers, He speaks to us. So we need to be sensitive to that, right? That's another way of deepening our fellowship, being sensitive, you know, not just in the natural realm, but in the spiritual, right? Being sensitive to the work of God, being sensitive to the communication of the Holy Spirit, right? And lastly, to be obedient. Right, to carry out the instruction, if there is an instruction, right? If He's leading, to follow obediently. Okay. So these are ways by which we can deepen our fellowship, koinonia, with the Holy Spirit. And it's very, very important, right? So let's now look at some aspects of the gifts. Let me just skip. No, you can just read through the book, and we have actually covered a lot of things about baptism of the Holy Spirit, about praying in tongues, and all that we've already covered, so we won't go there. I'm just skipping down to talk about the gifts themselves. Some more things about what the gifts are and how they should be used, and so on. Okay, let's just go down. Just give me a minute. Sorry. Okay. So when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit, you know, for purpose of study, you know, when we look into the scripture, we see that they are actually classified into three. Okay? There are three classifications when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit. And knowing this classification really, you know, puts to rest a lot of confusion. Okay. So what is this classification? Okay. It's when we classify, we are doing it for the purpose of studying, and also it doesn't mean that it strictly operates, the Holy Spirit operates in this way. There could be an overlap, right, between the gifts. But we see that, okay, there is one listing, 1 Corinthians 12. Okay, now these are called the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Now the gifts of the Holy Spirit, it talks about the fact that these are manifestations of the Spirit, and then, you know, the expression of the Spirit, and then we see 9 gifts listed there, right? Let's go there. 1 Corinthians 12. Yeah, 1 Corinthians 12, and then we read from 8 onwards, verse 8. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith, to another gifts of healings, to another working of miracles, discerning of spirits, different kinds of tongues, interpretation of tongues, and so on, right? So we see this listing there, and we see that these are called the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and these are for all believers, right? These are listed for all believers. Then we have something listed in Romans chapter 12. Okay, if you go back to Romans 12, okay? Romans chapter 12, and verse 5 onwards. So we being many, Romans 12 and verse 5. So we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. Okay, so it talks about people being part of the body and members of the body. And then we see these gifts that are listed there. Okay, so what are those? Says, if prophecy, let us prophesy. So we see prophecy as a gift. We see ministry, right? Serving, teaching, exhortation, giving, okay? Leading, leadership, then mercy, right? Compassion. So we see these gifts there. And the thing is this, it says that you are all members of the body of Christ. And when you, with these gifts, you use it, you minister to one another, okay? Then there's another classification of gifts we see in Ephesians chapter 4. Okay, so we saw 1 Corinthians 12. We saw Romans 12. Now we're looking at Ephesians chapter 4. Okay, and it says verse 11, right? For he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, okay, maybe we should just read from verse 7. But to each of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Okay, and then he goes on to verse 11 and he says, and he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And then goes on to talk about how we should come to the unity of faith and, you know, so all that, the work gifts continue to work. So we see these three classifications. One is gifts of the Spirit, and the second one, maybe we can call them as membership gifts, you know, you're members in the body of Christ. And then the third one being ministry gifts, ministry offices. So we see that the first two categories are for everyone. Okay, you're just being part of a body, and then God gives you or gives you that grace to function in the body of Christ. You know, it could be the local church, it could be anywhere, to function in the body of Christ so that you can be of service or you can minister to one another. Okay. The first two categories, we see this. But the third category, we see that he gave some, meaning that not all are given this particular gift. Okay. What is that? The fivefold ministry that we see. Right? Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, right? So we see very clearly that, well, he gave some. And the reason is this. He gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, okay? So for the equipping of the believers in the church, in the body, for the work of ministry, he says that, okay, some are called for this. Okay, so what is the difference then, right? What is the difference between the gifts of the Spirit and the membership gifts and ministry gifts, or the what we call as ministry offices? Well, this simple difference is this, that the ministry gift is something that the Lord decides, and it is something, it's like a call of God on our lives. Okay, like we are called to be maybe an evangelist, you are called to be a prophet, right? And this is what, this is going to be the primary thing that you're going to be doing because you're in the office of the evangelist, or you, this is your role, right? You're going to be an evangelist. It could be in any setting, but this is what you are. You're called to be the prophet, you're called to be a maybe pastor a church. This is what you are called to do, and it's a ministry office, and it's called the ministry gift. Okay, so can the apostle or someone who is a believer, can they go and pioneer a church? Can they do the work of an apostle? The answer is yes, right? Or, you know, like, I'm not an evangelist, but I'm a believer, but can I evangelize? Yes. Like, I can share the gospel, right? So the thing is this, that all believers, they can actually, you know, they can evangelize, they can maybe go pioneer a church, they can pastor, I mean, pastor in the sense, they can, you know, encourage, nourish someone, nurture someone in the word of God. They can definitely teach, you know, the work of. So all believers can do that, but not all believers are called into that ministry office or ministry gift of the fivefold ministry. Right? Not all are called. So we need to understand that. Okay. Any questions on this? Chapter 12. Yeah. Okay, Romans 12. The question on that. Yeah, so your question is how we operate these gifts, like how I'm so for all of it, so what is the grace of God? Okay, we'll come to that. So the grace of God is it's something that is given freely, something that is unmerited. It's a favor of God. Okay, so that is what it means. And it's it's a gift of grace. It's something that we don't earn it, but it's given freely. So that is what it means, right? So when it says that, okay, we have where is that verse? Verse 6. Gifts according to the grace that is given to us. It just means that, yeah, this has been freely given to us, okay, from God. And according to his grace, he has given. According to, his will, desire, plan, and it's been freely given to us. So that is... Okay, so is he saying that, okay, Prince, now I'd like to give you this... I'd like to give you the gift of leadership so that you can be of service. You can, you know, release that gift among the body. Yes, it could be so also, right? So the thing is this, okay, so when we are in the body of Christ, we are all placed in the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians 12, in the spiritual body of Christ. But we are also part of let's say a local church or maybe a small home church, whatever expression of that body of Christ is, you know, in that particular setting, we're all part of that. So in that setting, you know, what does God really want you to function like? And what does he want you to do in your local church, right? So he gives that grace, and according to that grace, he gives grace gift, right? So that he's saying, okay, now this particular fellowship needs your leadership, and it's a grace gift. It's not something we're going to look at that. It's not something that you learnt. It's not an ability that you learnt naturally, but it's a supernatural ability. And it says here, you know, you lead with diligence. Okay, so you're called to do this, you lead with diligence, and so on. So it's in the body of Christ, right? Any other questions? Yeah. Forced into one of these. Okay. So let's say compelled into that. Okay. He doesn't have the grace. Okay. One of these. Mm. Okay, so Rinchen's question is, okay, now you look at these fivefold ministry gifts, and I see that, okay, man, prophet, I want it. I think I'm called for that. Okay, so that's my desire, and I'm just starting to, you know, I just go after that. But I realize that it's not what God wants me to be, right? I realize, or others realize, so should I continue? The answer is no. Right. If you know for a fact that this is not that place, and you don't have to continue in it, you know, and then you seek God. Okay, God. But the thing, the beautiful thing is this, once you come to know Christ and you're serving Him and you're seeking Him, worshiping Him, you know, as you journey with Christ, He is actually putting those desires in your heart. Okay. And He's giving the grace, and you begin to see that, okay, as you begin to walk in it, as you begin to serve people, minister to people in it, according to what He's put in your heart, the desires, you begin to see His grace in operation. And you begin to see the power of God in operation. And then people also begin to see that, and the fruit of that ministry, people also begin to see that, okay, I'm blessed. I'm really blessed by what you shared, what you did, how you served, etc. So there's both ways. You are also feeling God's pleasure, you know, when you do that. You know that deep within there's a witness in your spirit, and you want to go after that. It's not something in the fleshly realm, but it's something deep within. And so it works both ways. And then you see that, okay, you've been serving, you've been ministering, and then you see that God puts you in one of those fivefold ministries, you know, which may happen, which may not also, but God calls you into that. And then you realize that that's the primary thing that you're doing. You know, you're maybe as an apostle, that's the thing that you're doing. Because everywhere you see people, you want to plant a church, right? You're like, I want to pioneer, you know, these people, they've not reached with the gospel. I want to share the gospel. Start work there. Some Bible studies, some say start there and start a work there. You want to see it grow. So that's your desire. Wherever you see, you know, that's your desire. And then God honors that. And that desire came from Him in the first place. Right? So, yeah. So the thing is to go with what God is putting in you, drawing you to become, rather than being enamored by, oh, wow, it'll be so cool to be a prophet, you know, to say those things, to call out that name. I just want to do that. Or, you know, I want to be a worship leader. Wow, you just get to be there on stage and do it and lead in song. I want to be. Rather than that, to go with what God's putting in your heart. And also, you know, you see that, okay, He's placing you in those environments. He's placing you, you know, those opportunities. And you begin to do that. And then, well, you know that you're delighting God's heart, and you're also being a blessing to others. And then you're called to more of that. Yeah. Like confession from my side, I didn't want to lead worship. Like every time people said, because there was actually a need for when in the fellowship where I was, you know, there's a need for people to. Some musicians, somebody to lead and all that. And I every time it was my turn, I would just say no, I would just keep away. That was not my desire. But then once I came to know the Lord, this became it's a natural outflow of the heart. Yeah. So that's a long answer. Yes, Prince. If you desire the gifts of the Spirit, yes. Yeah. So, the Bible talks about pursuing love, desiring spiritual gifts. So you're desiring. So the pathway could be like this. Could be like this. So you're desiring spiritual gifts. Okay, so maybe, so the instruction is desire spiritual gifts, plural. Okay, go for everything. Don't stop with one thing or two things, just go for everything. Desire spiritual gifts. And you begin to minister, and God presents you with opportunities, you begin to serve that. Then, okay, you're in the church, And again, you see that God is using you more and more in certain things, right? In a particular thing, you desire that, you do that. Then you see that there's, it could work both ways. In the sense, you're really desiring. God has put this thing to maybe, just travel to places and go where God's word is not preached, and then evangelize, share. So as, let's say, for example, ministry gift of the evangelist. And that is the stirring. Every time you're traveling in a train, going in a bus, you want to share the gospel. You want to share Christ. That is a stirring. That's what you eat, breathe, and sleep, right? And that's there. And then you see that God is, there is a commissioning that happens. There is an equipping, there is a training, there is a commissioning that happens. So you're, conveyed into that, right? So what happens, if this is what you're doing, but for some reason, you are saying, okay, actually I want that. Now, we should really question that why. Why do you want that? if it's a deep desire that God has put in your heart, there'll be overlap of gifts. Like, for example, you could be a pastor teacher, right? There could be overlap. You could be an apostle prophet, right? And so we see both streams just there. In the nurturing of people, there's a lot of, like Pastor Ajish, for example, pastor teacher, right? Or apostle, prophetic, and all that flowing together. So there's a thing to, I want to plant these people in the word of God. That's the thing which comes, get the word of God, teach, you need to know the word, you need to live by the word. So there's a deep thing, revelation, understanding, all coming out in books and all that, get the word in so people can live by the word. So, and at the same time, the pastoral as well, and the apostolic, preaching, planting. So you see all that in operation. So God will use that as well. One would be very prominent, maybe. These are all, there's no chapter and verse, but we're just looking back and saying, okay, it could manifest in this way, right? In the sense, one could be very, very prophetic in nature, and also maybe, the teaching bit could be a not so prominent thing. Teaching about the prophetic, maybe not so prominent, but then the prophetic is thing prominent. So it could be like that. It could be a stream of multiple gifts. Yeah, Anand. Yeah. Sorry, when we? Yeah, absolutely. So you're saying, okay, can these gifts be used to minister to people who do not know Christ? Right? That's what you're saying from a different background. Absolutely. And Jesus did it all the time, right? And when they came to him with the need. It's not like they wanted to follow him. In fact, out of those lepers, only one came back to thank. Other guys were, I'm going. This man. So it didn't matter to the Lord. He healed anyway out of the goodness of his heart, because that's his name, right? So so he healed. So your question, okay, can the gifts be used outside of the walls of the church? It should be. Yeah, it's an amazing avenue to point people to Christ, because these signs and wonders are like signboards pointing to the power of God. Power and the person of Jesus. So we will do well to, once we've ministered, to point people to Christ. Now, people might say, okay, they got healed, but they're not following Christ. That will happen, because, but they can't stay that way for a long time. There's something in their heart, right? They know that, okay. And so absolutely, whether it's prophecy or healing or, word of wisdom, everything, it belongs. Actually, see why? Because these gifts are expression of the Holy Spirit. Okay, so manifestation. So what is God's heart? That people come to saving knowledge of Christ, right? So So since that is his heart of compassion and love, and the people should not perish, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Okay. So we see this. Any other? Yeah, Sean. Your question is, okay, if I'm not called to, let's say, for example, if I'm not called to be a pastor, but I just keep going, what will be the end consequence of it, right? Yeah, I mean, he will always, knowing the heart of God, he will always, Jesus, God who speaks, he's going to talk to you on a daily basis, moment by moment basis. So maybe I'm so caught up in everything, doing things, ministry, that I'm not really listening to his voice in these things, that I'm just going with the flow. Well, God will continue to speak. God will continue to, gently nudge you, but he'll continue to, he'll use any means. If you're going to be speaking to people, encouraging them, nurturing them in the word, he will use you, but you will be at your best doing something else. Right? So that's the thing. So, but he will anyway. That's a beautiful thing. It's not a formula, because it's a relationship with God, right? So when we walk with God, he's going to be speaking. He's going to be, maybe he'll use other people to encourage you, to nudge you. And as long as you're listening, he'll lead you into that. Yeah. And you'll see, when you're in the wrong place, maybe you're not that satisfied, you somehow have this feeling, maybe I'm meant to be somewhere else. You have that hunger, that kind of a thing, restlessness in your heart. But the thing is, yeah, he will show, he will lead. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and it's how do we know that we have the in a particular gift, is it? Okay. So the thing is, we're going to look at some of those aspects. The Holy Spirit is a person, he indwells, right? And he's the one who releases the gifts. And as believers, we are supposed to pursue, desire the gifts. Okay. All of them. Okay. Now, he orchestrates those moments, those opportunities, those needs. And when, you'll see that, okay, again and again, people come back to me with their, their problems. And I'm just, I don't know from where this wisdom comes, but I'm just giving that, maybe one or two statements, and it seems to solve the things. And then you see that God is using you in that word of wisdom. He gives that supernatural counsel and wisdom, and that seems to solve the puzzle, solve the problem for them, and they go back very satisfied. And yeah, so you see, one is the frequency with which God uses you in a particular way. And then you realize that, okay, God, you're moving me in that direction. So it's a journey again. Yeah, so you will know. Sometimes you might say like how it happened for me, you might be most frustrated with that thing. I don't want to do that. I don't want to get into that, because maybe you had a bad experience, or maybe there's something, some fears, some anxieties and everything, because of which you don't want to get into that, right? I'll just share this example. This whole thing of worship, right? I see on question, I'll just come back in a minute. So thing of worship for me, I was very, very conscious of people, like who was listening, who was watching. And so I was like, how can I lead people? And then, how can I do this? So I was very conscious. So every time I would stay away, right? Whenever there was opportunity, stay away. Whenever people invite, just stay away from it. But then all that changed when I listened to one of the, I don't know if you know Ron Kennelly, there was a concert here. And then he said something, which he just started the whole worship evening with this one statement. He said, hey, to me, it does not matter whether you're here or not. That's how he started. And all of us are gathered there for the worship. He said, it doesn't matter whether you're here or not to me, because I'm always ministering or worshiping to an audience of one. Okay, he said, audience of one. That's my focus. So when he said that, something happened to me. It's like, hey, that is my main problem. I'm always thinking about the people, which you need to, but then my I'm so, you know, conscious of people that I'm forgetting, actually, I'm ministering, you know, unto the Lord. So when he said that, something changed in me. So I went back, and then the next time, I said, yeah, sure. And so it didn't matter whether there was, you know, 300 people, didn't matter at all, because it's always for, and so much of fear, anxiety, all that left, you know. So, yeah, so the thing is, yeah, so maybe there are some things preventing us, you know, even to step into that fullness of what God is calling us, but it's a journey. There will be refining, there will be the chipping away. That is what the training is. You know, God sets us up so that we have received from Him, and we receive strength and all that, and we continue to pursue Him, and then He conveys us into that place, right? Yeah. Does it answer? Yeah. Okay. I see Nina's question. How does one know that one is called to be part of the fivefold ministry? Yeah, Nina. So the thing is, okay, like we said, again, the pathway, you know, for all believers, all the gifts. So we pursue God, we pursue the giver, and then we start serving someplace. The best place is, of course, the place where you have fellowship with, you know, the body of believers. So you begin to, you know, serve there, and the Lord uses it, or He manifests these gifts so that others will be edified. That is something that we see, right? So people are edified. So you begin to serve. You know, you begin to expect, maybe the people have some need. You pray. You ask God, you know, what do I do? And maybe you're praying for them, and then the Lord reveal certain things about them, word of knowledge, word of wisdom. Maybe there's a need, physical need, you know, there's healing, there's miracles. So the Lord begins to answer that in these ways. And you see that your heart is moving in a certain direction as you begin to serve. You know, you want to take care of, you know, certain things. Maybe you have a burden, in other words. You know, there's a weight. There's something that is drawing you to maybe the poor. You know, there's always that compassion. You want to see, you want to, you know, feed, you want to, you know, and it need not be, you know, all these kind of, it could be like, oh, I see garbage, I see trash everywhere in the city, and I just feel drawn. I want to clean this place up, right? And it could be something, you know, like that, unspiritual like that. But the fact is that Lord is, you know, drawing you into that. Okay, but your question is, you know, fivefold ministry. It's the same thing, right? So the Lord draws you, gives you a need, a burden, and then you, as you begin to do more of it, you. Yeah, you begin to see yourself walking in it. You know, that's the thing. So some things for us to consider is not to be conscious or be concerned about the label, the tag, right? So many times we are conscious, no? People are you a pastor or an evangelist? Or you, because you want to put it on that card, right? Pastor so-and-so, evangelist so-and-so, apostle so-and-so. Don't be worried about that. You know, Don't just be caught up in that tag. Just minister. Right? Just minister as the way the Lord leads. And actually, people will call you that. You know, people will either call you, oh, this person is very prophetic, or this person is very pastoral, and you know, he's got a pastor's heart. And so they will begin to recognize that, right? So the thing is to actually start serving. Start ministering, because ministry is about serving with the power of God, with the abilities that He gives us. I hope that helps, Nina. When we are burdened, how should we approach that call from God? So I guess you're saying, okay, you're burdened about something. Okay, so We brought the box thing over and over again, and the thing is to again take it back to him. That there is a need. So sometimes maybe just God to pray, right? And most times he wants you to be part of the solution, right? Do something about it. And the reason that you have the burden is because you're praying about it, and then he gives you some strategy, something to get involved so that you can do something about it. Okay, so as you pray, see if there are opportunities, you know, as you collect information about that particular burden. Okay, see if you can find out any information about the people, about the place, maybe about that particular thing. Find out, okay, and pray again, pray more. Okay, Lord, I have this thing about this need, pray more. And you see if God is opening up, you know, opportunities for you to actually be involved in that particular thing, right? And then, yeah, that would be a good way to go about it. I hope that helps, Chaya. Yeah. Okay. So we looked at, if you have any more thoughts, you can just put it on the chat, please. So we looked at, you know, the gifts of the Spirit, the difference between ministry gifts. Actually, we, you know, when we were talking about the gift of tongues, we looked at that, you know, 1 Corinthians 12:28. We also saw that there are ministry offices that the Lord places in the church, and we should not confuse that with ministry gifts, right? I'm sorry, gifts of the Spirit, which are for all. Yeah, sorry. Of the notes, huh? I'm actually skipping a lot. I'm just going through, sorry. okay, I'll just tell you, and this is not, can I just WhatsApp it to you later? Right? We'll be looking at the book, Gifts of the Spirit, not the notes. You got that? Okay, okay, fine. For some reason, the page number is not showing up. I'm on that liquid mode, so, okay. Okay, so what do I do about these gifts? Just a few more statements and then we'll... okay. First thing to... Okay, this topic is called Understanding the Gifts of the Spirit. Probably you can just do a search and go there. Understanding the Gifts of the Spirit. Okay, when it comes to... gifts of the Spirit, understanding the things to keep in mind. Okay, firstly, the gifts are for all believers. Okay, the gifts are for all believers. So maybe if you're leading a particular prayer group or a church, when God is pastoring and you called you to be a leader, just understand that it's for all believers. You know, and if all believers begin to pursue, receive, and walk in it, that body, that church is going to be a powerful, thriving church. Because they begin to hear from God, they've been ministering. They are not just coming to hear a sermon, but they are going to be doers of God's word, right? Doers of the works of God. And that is what you want, right? People to discover the call, discover the, you know, the grace of God, and do what God wants them. So the gifts of the Spirit are for all believers, are given to all believers. Okay, how can I say that? Why do I say that? It's for all believers. Because we need to have a biblical base, right? We can't just say gifts are for all believers, and there's no verse in scripture which, or at least indirectly conveying that. Okay, so online class also, why do we say that? Or how can we say that? The gifts of the Spirit are for all believers. Looked at it last class. Okay, one thing, first thing that comes to my mind is, and also we have it in the notes, is this Paul's exhortation about the gifts. What does he say? Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. He doesn't say, okay, you desire gifts 1, 3, and 5. forget about the rest. He says, pursue spiritual, desire, pursue love, desire, spiritual gifts. So there's no limit. There's no limit, right? And he's writing to the Corinthian church, every believer who was actually meeting there. So he's saying, pursue love, desire, spiritual gifts. So it's for everybody, okay? It's not for some special people. And just because you are, you receive certain gifts, that doesn't mean that you are way special than the others. No, it is for all people. Okay. Then there is also one admonition that Paul ministers, one rebuke, right? Instruction about prayer. Right? Where do we see that? Ephesians 6. Right. Ephesians chapter 6. Let's go there quickly. Ephesians 6 and verse 18. Okay, no, Ephesians 6, it talks about bond servants, he talks about children. Then in verse 10, he talks about, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. Okay, verse 10, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, which is for the Ephesian church. You go down, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Okay, so we see that there is a gift which is mentioned there, which is the gift of the praying in the Spirit, which is the gift of tongues. Obviously, we're talking about only about this. Then we see that that's a weapon, that is armor for the believer, and it is for all believers, right? It is for all. It is not just for some. Okay, so then going back to that list, which we see in 1 Corinthians 12. Okay? Can we just go there? 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 7. Okay. What does it say? The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. So the manifestation, what is the manifestation of the Spirit? The gifts of the Spirit. Okay. So the gifts of the Spirit are called as the manifestation of the Spirit. So the manifestation of the Spirit is given to who? Everyone, right? Is given to each one for the benefit of all. Okay. So to see, these are some verses, I'm sure there are many, but these are some verses which indicate that it is for all. The gifts of the Spirit are for all people. Okay, we need to, first thing is that we understand that, okay, it's for me. Okay, so all these gifts are for me. Sometimes we cancel out, right? We cancel ourselves. We think, okay, it's for all, but they're not doesn't include me. Sometimes we do that, right? When you're counting for some particular thing, some event or something, we count everybody. We forget our own name. We forget to include ours in the count, right? You're taking a head count. Well, it includes you. It includes me. It's for all. Then the gifts of the Spirit are gifts of grace, and these are not supernatural ability. These are not naturally trained or natural abilities. For example, when we say gifts of healing, yes, the body can heal by itself. Yes or no? Last week I cut my finger while cutting an apple. Now I can't even see where that cut is. Right, you remember I was wearing that brace last class, and now it's like almost 99%. It's fine. I can just move my wrist without any pain. The body heals, right? So to administer healing, of course, we can also, we have medically trained people, doctors who know certain things, so that they can, either hasten that healing, etc., whatever. But this is not that. When we say gifts of healing, it's not that, Dr. So-and-so is healing, or, paramedic so-and-so is bringing about healing. It is something that is because of the grace of God. It is supernaturally enabled, right? So when you say gift of tongues, it's not that I learned, Hindi and French and Kannada. No, this is something that has been given to me supernaturally. It's not something that I learned, like alphabets or grammar and sentences. So the gifts of the Spirit are gifts of grace. These are supernaturally given. And the word there is pneumatikos, spiritual, enabled by the Holy Spirit. Okay, right. These are gifts of grace, meaning we didn't earn it. Okay, so you don't earn it. Sometimes we think, okay, I've been a believer for so many years. I deserve this. I deserve to have walk in this gift. No, right? We just deserve to walk in humility, or we need to walk in humility. But these are gifts of grace. He gives. And sometimes it's that person. I know how his life is. I know that, you know, these are areas that he's trying to overcome. He's walking in these gifts. Well, grace is like that. The Jewish people got so offended. Well, we have the law. How can the Gentiles be saved? Right? Paul's letter about Romans, to the Romans, the entire thing is about that. Right? Yeah, we were people who were given the law, but then grace, out of the grace of God, people are saved. There is the righteousness which is apart from the law, just through the grace of God. Right? So we see that. So it's a gift of grace. It's not something that we earn. Okay. The gifts of the Spirit are given to edify people. Okay. What does edify mean? Build up. Yeah. So it's bringing something in people's lives. Right, edifying, you know, if it's a word of knowledge, a word, people are edified. You can actually see the difference when the gift is in operation, when the Holy Spirit, you know, just releases that, maybe a word of encouragement, maybe a word of knowledge, something, it builds up people in the Spirit. People are encouraged, people are built up, people are like, wow, I don't know, for hours I was like this, but now in an instant, something has happened in my spirit. I'm built up, edified. Right? So gifts of Spirit edify people and glorify God. They build up people, they point to Christ. Sometimes people, you know, make the mistake of pointing to oneself, right? But then no, they are actually, if the gifts are ministered in all humility, they point to Christ, they glorify God. Okay. Examples. We see about the gifts building up. Okay, apart from practical things of wording, I mean, receiving a word of knowledge, we see Romans chapter 1 and verse 11 and 12. No, it's interesting, and we need to know this. Romans chapter 1, verse 11. These are the words of Paul, and this is what he says. I long to see you. He's writing to the church, which is in Rome. I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift so that you may be established. So that you may be established, meaning you may be strong. You will be, you know, rooted, right? You will be made strong, made unmovable, established, made firm, rather. And what is causing that firmness or establishing? It is the spiritual gifts. He's saying, you know, I want to meet you so that I might impart to you, which means that he's going to maybe teach them, maybe pray over them, lay hands on them, whatever. And he says, you know, this will, so that you may be established. So the gifts of Spirit edify people. Okay? Don't forget that. It's not some flashy thing, but it's to edify, build up people. And it's something which will build the church. Right, just imagine, even if there are 2-3 people and, you know, you're teaching about the gifts and people's eyes are open and they know that, oh, this is for me. And they, which means when they realize that, okay, it is for them, then they're able to extend faith, that you need faith to receive from him. And then, you know, they expect God, ask the Holy Spirit, and he gives that gift of grace. Okay. Okay. So we'll stop here. And then we'll continue next class, right? Thank you, everyone.